Flexbox is a pain in the ass. As someone that's struggled with Flexbox longer than I'd like to admit, I know how frustrating it can be to learn.
I'm in a glass case of emotion!
That's why, in this video, I'll explain everything you need to know about Flexbox in a way that hopefully appeases the YouTube algorithm gods. Flexbox is a CSS layout method that's divided into two primary components, the Flexbox container and its contents, which are referred to as flex items. You define Flexbox on an element by setting the CSS display property to flex. You'll notice that the elements are now positioned left to right on a single row when I did that. This happens because the CSS property flex direction, which has a default value of row. This invisible line these items are on is called the main axis, which is important to remember for later in the video. Flex direction has three more possible values: row reverse, column, and column reverse. Row reverse is the same as row, but the flex items align right to left. Column shifts the main axis and aligns the flex items from top to bottom. And column reverse aligns the items from bottom to top. Now, let's say you want to change the alignment of the items on the main axis to help distribute the extra space left over in the parent container. To achieve this, you would use the CSS property called justify content. Right now, the flex items have justify content set to the default value of flex start, which aligns the items towards the start of the flex direction. The flex end property is similar to flex start, but aligns the items towards the end of the flex direction. The center property aligns the items towards the center of the flex direction. The space between property evenly distributes the items, but places the first and last items at the start and end of the line. The space around property distributes the items with equal space around each individual item. This means the first and last item's outermost edges have 1 unit of space, while the inside spaces have 2 units of space. The space evenly property distributes the same amount of space between each item, including the space around the first and last item's outermost edges. So far, we've only discussed the main axis of the flex items, but there's one more we need to discuss: the cross axis. The cross axis runs perpendicular to the main axis. So for row flex directions, the cross axis is here, while on column flex directions, the cross axis is here. Sometimes you'll want to align flex items to this axis, which you can do using the align items CSS property. The default value is stretch, which stretches the flex items to fill the parent container while still respecting the max height and min width CSS properties. Flex start aligns the items to the start of the cross axis, while flex end aligns them to the end. Center will center all the items, while baseline means that if the flex items contain text, the text will be aligned along the baseline, or a common imaginary line upon which the text of each item sits. One more alignment property can be placed on the flex container, but before we discuss that, we need to talk about flex wrap. Flex items have a default value for flex wrap set to no wrap, which means the items will adjust their size to try and fit into one line. You can change that behavior by setting the value to wrap, which will wrap the items onto multiple lines from top to bottom. The other property, wrap reverse, will wrap the items onto multiple lines from bottom to top. We needed to cover flex wrap before we covered the final alignment property, because this alignment property only matters if you have flex items that wrap multiple rows. With that, the final alignment property you need to know is align content. A flex container's default alignment content value is normal, meaning that the items are packed into their default position. To override this, you have a few popular options, including flex start, flex in, center, stretch, space between, space around, and space evenly. Finally, there's one more property you need to learn about flex containers: row gap and column gap. Setting row gap will add space between the elements on the rows, while column gap will add space to the elements on the columns. There's also a shorthand method called gap. Setting two values will set the row and column gap, while setting one value sets the same value for the row and column gap. You can think of these properties as a minimum gutter between your elements, meaning that you can ensure that the elements will get no closer to each other than the set value. Now that we've looked at all the CSS properties that can be placed on the flex container, let's look at the properties that can be placed on the flex items. First, let's consider flex grow, which defines the ability of a flex item to grow within its parent container if needed. A flex item has a default flex grow property of 0, meaning that it will take up as much space as needed based on the content inside, unless you specifically set a width or height on the item. The unitless value is a proportion for Flexbox to figure out how much space to allot to the flex item. For example, if each flex item has a flex grow of 1, they'll all occupy equal space. However, if one of the flex items has a flex grow of 2, it will be twice the size of the flex items with a flex grow of 1. The next property, flex shrink, works the same way as flex grow, but defines the ability of a flex item to shrink within its parent container if needed. The next property we'll cover is flex basis, which sets the default size of an element before the remaining space is distributed. The default value is auto, which means look at my width and height and distribute extra space based on my flex grow values. This value can also be a length, like pixels, rem, or percentages. If the value is set to 0, the extra space around the content isn't factored in. For example, as you can see in this visual, when the flex basis is 0, the elements that have flex grow set to 1 are the same size. However, when the flex basis is set to auto, the size is different, but the spacing around the content is the same. Also, it's common for flex basis to get confused with width, but the important thing to remember is that the width sets a fixed value. And you may be asking, but wouldn't setting a width of 25% on an element have the same effect on setting the flex basis to 25%? The answer is no, because the width is relative to the parent container. With flex basis, the size is calculated based on the available space, which considers properties like row and column gap when calculating its size. You can also define all three of the above properties in one shorthand property called flex, which sets the flex grow, flex shrink, and flex basis. You can set some more properties on flex items that are important to know, but you might not be using as frequently. One of those properties is order. By default, flex items are laid out depending on the order they appear in your HTML, but you can change that with the order property. This property even supports negative numbers. The next property is align self, which lets the flex item break apart from the alignment that was set on the flex container's align items property. Just like the align items property, this item takes the same possible values and applies it directly to the individual flex item. Now that you know all the ins and outs of Flexbox, you'll need to put those skills to practice before the concepts really set in. One way to practice is to find the layouts you like on sites like Dribbble and try to recreate them. This can feel overwhelming, but remember to focus on creating the general layout instead of the entire design. A couple of other fun options are Flexbox Froggy and Flexbox Defense, which are games that let you apply your Flexbox knowledge to complete the levels. And that's it for this crash course on Flexbox. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up and share it with your fellow developers who might also benefit from it. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so you won't miss any future videos like this one. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Until then, happy coding.